Good morning, students. So today we had focused on the chapter which is the Divine Comedy, the third part of this Divine Comedy, which is Paradiso. And regarding the chapter that we had focused on is the 21st chapter, which is the seventh sphere, Saturn. So regarding the title, Paradiso Canto 21, the sphere of Saturn. So now we had focused on regarding the author's details, who is Dante. So Dante Alighieri was a major Italian poet of the late Middle Ages. And also his time period is from 1265 to 1321. And his Divine Comedy is widely considered as the greatest literary work composed in the Italian language and a masterpiece of world literature. So basically, the Divine Comedy is considered as the greatest literary work composed in the Italian language, and also it is the masterpiece of world literature. Then, Dante has been called as the father of the Italian language and one of the greatest poets of world literature. So regarding the poet, he was called as the father of the Italian language and one of the greatest poets of world literature. So basically, this epic, which is the Divine Comedy, is a masterpiece of world literature. And also regarding the poet, Dante has been called as the father of the Italian language and one of the greatest poets of world literature. In Italy, Dante is often referred to as Il Sommo Poeta, which means the supreme poet. Then Dante, Petrarch and Boccaccio are also called as the three fountains or three crowns of the Italian literature. So basically here we had focused on regarding the Dante. So he was called as the father of the Italian language and one of the greatest poets of world literature. And regarding this Divine Comedy, it is widely considered as the greatest literary work composed in the Italian language and also the masterpiece of world literature. So that's regarding some important details regarding the author, who is Dante Alighieri. Now we had to focus on regarding this poem, which is the Paradiso Canto 21, the Sphere of Saturn. So first we had to focus on regarding the content of this poem. So basically here we had to focus on the 133 lines of this poem, which is the chapter 21, which is the Canto 21. So here the Canto means the chapter of this poem. So in our last class we discussed regarding the introduction part for this chapter, in which the 10 major spheres, and also regarding the introduction for the Divine Comedy. So today we had to focus on this chapter itself, which is the Divine Comedy, especially the chapter 21, the Sphere of Saturn. So regarding the main content of this poem, Dante ascends with Beatrice to the seventh heaven, which is the planet Saturn, and he turns to face Beatrice, but she is not smiling. She explains that if she smiles, Dante would turn into ashes, because they have climbed so high that they have reached the point where Dante's mortal senses cannot bear the brilliance of God's reflected love. So this is the first point that you had to keep in mind regarding the experience of Dante regarding this spiritual journey to the sphere of Saturn. So here Dante and Beatrice, they move to the seventh sphere, which is the sphere of Saturn or the planet of Saturn. Then he turns, which means Dante turns to face Beatrice, but she is not smiling. Then she explains that if she smiles, Dante would turn to ashes, because they have climbed so high that they have reached the point where Dante's mortal senses cannot bear the brilliance of God's reflected love. Then second point is that she announces that they are now in the seventh heaven. So they have reached the seventh heaven. Beatrice tells him to look where he would usually look, and he will see the reflected image of what comes next. So Dante looks at Beatrice's eyes. There he sees the landscape of Saturn reflected. So this is the second point that we had to keep in mind, in which Beatrice tells him to look where he would usually look, and he will see the reflected image of what comes next. So basically Dante looks at Beatrice's eyes. So basically Beatrice was his guide. So Dante just looks at Beatrice's eyes. There he sees the landscape of Saturn, which is reflected. And the third point is that, and rising from it, it is a magnificent golden ladder extending so high that Dante cannot see its top. Climbing down the steps of the ladder are thousands upon thousands of souls. Dante compares their movements, gathering together and flitting about once they reach the surface of Saturn, to the movement of the flock of jackdaws. So here the jackdaws means a kind of bird, a kind of local bird. So basically here we had to focus on regarding the third important point. And rising from it, it is a magnificent golden ladder extending so high that Dante cannot see its top. So basically here we have a golden ladder, and also climbing down the steps of the ladder are thousands upon thousands of souls. Then regarding the movements of the souls, it is compared to the movement of flock of jackdaws. So that's regarding the third important point. Then the fourth point is that Dante turns his attention to the nearest soul and thinks that he is so bright. He must be eager to speak, but he must wait permission from Beatrice before speaking to the soul. At this unspoken thought, Beatrice promptly gives the signal and Dante's words are unleashed. So here, Dante waits for the permission from Beatrice before speaking to the soul. So at this unspoken thought, Beatrice promptly gives the signal and Dante's words are unleashed. So this is the fourth point that we had to keep in mind, in which Dante asks two important questions to a soul. So Dante asks the aforementioned soul why he stepped up so close and why there is an unnatural silence in this sphere, whereas every other sphere is thundered with glorious music. So here we have two important questions. The first one is that why he stepped up so close. The second question is that why there is an unnatural silence in this sphere. So the soul chooses to answer the second question first. Then the answer for that question was that it's quiet here. He says, if we sing, it would burst your eardrums. So this is the answer for the first question, in which Dante's mortal hearing could not handle the glory of singing at this level of heaven. Then regarding the second question, the soul answers that he descended the golden ladder with the purpose of meeting Dante. So the answer for the second question was that to meet Dante. So basically he descended the golden ladder with the purpose of meeting Dante. So this is the fourth point that we had to keep in mind. So the first one was regarding that Dante ascends with Beatrice to the seventh heaven. So the reason for that was that if she smiles, Dante would turn to ashes, because they have climbed so high that they have reached the point where Dante's mortal senses cannot bear the brilliance of God's reflected love. Second one is regarding the reflected image, in which when they reach the seventh heaven, Beatrice tells him to look where he would usually look and he will see the reflected image of what comes next. Then the third point was regarding the golden ladder, and the fourth one was regarding meeting a soul and also asking two important questions from Dante to that soul. So that's regarding the four important points that we had to keep in mind. Then following that, but he qualifies his answer with a humbling remark. It's not that God particularly favors this soul more than the others, only that this soul is governed by God's will and thus obeys when told to move down the ladder. Okay, says Dante, I understand that you have aligned your will with God's, but I still don't understand why you in particular were predestined to meet me. Before he can even say the last words, the spirit begins spinning so fast as it can go. Then his spinning only makes the soul grow brighter. And he replies, my sight is good, which is why God blesses me with so much grace. But stop asking why, Dante. Nobody can know the mind of God, and you would do well to remind your fellow men of that when you return below. His haughty words make Dante take a step back. So basically here Dante asks regarding the identity of the soul, and also he asks a specific question, in which why you in particular were predestined to meet me. എന്തുകൊണ്ടാണ് എന്നെ മാത്രം കാണാൻ വേണ്ടിയിട്ട് ഇവിടേക്ക് വന്നത് എന്നൊരു ചോദ്യം ചോദിക്കുകയാണ്. സോ ബേസിക്കലി ദി ആൻസർ ഫോർ ദാറ്റ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ വാസ് ദാറ്റ് മൈ സൈറ്റ് ഈസ് ഗുഡ് വിച്ച് ഈസ് വൈ ഗോഡ് ബ്ലെസ്സസ് മീ വിത്ത് സോ മച്ച് ഗ്രേസ് ബട്ട് സ്റ്റോപ്പ് ആസ്കിംഗ് വൈ ഡാൻഡെ നോബഡി ക്യാൻ നോ ദി മൈൻഡ് ഓഫ് ഗോഡ് and you would do well to remind your fellow men of that when you return below. So this was the answer by that soul. Then we have the fifth point that we had to keep in mind, in which thoroughly humbled, Dante meekly asks the soul his identity. Then the blasting soul responds that he once worshipped God in a place called Catria, specifically in the monastery of Santa Croce di Forte Avellana. And in his meditation there, he was happy to live on a diet of veggies cooked only in olive juice. That monastery, the soul continues, used to turn out virtuous souls like clockwork, but it is now barren. So this was the reality of that specific monastery. So here that soul specifically introduced this place of that soul, in which it was the Catria, specifically the monastery of Santa Cruz de Forte Avellana. And also regarding the food, in his meditation there, he was happy to live on a diet of veggies cooked only in olive juice. So basically this soul is from that specific monastery. Then the sixth point that you had to keep in mind is that then he names himself as Saint Peter Damien. Dante notes its realization. Saint Peter Damien continues his story. He was called as Peter the Sinner when he first came to the monastery. From this place, he was reluctantly dragged out and eventually became a cardinal. So basically, he was the Peter the Sinner, and now he was called as Saint Peter Damien. So he reveals his identity, in which when he first came to the monastery, he was called as Peter the Sinner, and later he was called as Saint Peter Damien because of his life. So from this place, he was reluctantly dragged out and eventually became a cardinal. So that's regarding the sixth point, second last point that we had to keep in mind. Now we have the final part of this poem, in which this gives Peter an opportunity to blast the papal seat. So here the papal seat means the seat of Pope. Then he recounts how popes were once good, as when Saint Paul wore the hat, he walked barefoot and was lean. But now Peter shakes his head. The popes are so plump that they have need of one to prop them up on this side, one of that and one in front, and one to host them saddlebart. Peter's words have attracted the souls, who are now gathered round in a spectacle of light. When Peter stops speaking, they cry out in agreement, and Dante drops like an anchor. Their combined voice have overwhelmed his senses, as Saint Peter warned before. So that's regarding the seventh point that you had to keep in mind. So here Saint Peter gives an opportunity to blast the Pope's seat, the papal seat, and he recounts how popes were once good, as when Saint Paul wore the hat, he walked barefoot and was lean. And but now Peter shakes his head, in which the popes are so plump that they have need of one to prop them up on this side, one of that and one in front, and one to host them saddlebar. So basically this is regarding the seat of this Pope. So according to Saint Peter, he says that he recounts that how popes were once good, and when Saint Paul wore the hat, he walked barefoot and was lean. So after Saint Peter stops speaking, they cry out in agreement. So here the souls cry out in agreement, and Dante drops like an anchor. Their combined voices have overwhelmed his senses, as Saint Peter warned before. So that's regarding the seventh point that you had to keep in mind regarding the content of this chapter, which is Paradise, Canto 21, which is the seventh heaven, the sphere of Saturn. Now we had to focus on this poem itself. Again, mine eyes were fixed on Beatrice, and with mine eyes, my soul that in her looks found all contentment, yet no smile she wore, and did I smile, quoth she, though wouldest be straight, like smile when into ashes turned, for mounting these eternal places stairs, my beauty, which the loftier it climbs, as thou hast noted, still doth kindle more, so shines that were no tempering interposed, thy mortal poisons would from its rays shrink as the leaf doth from the thunderbolt. Into the seventh splendor are we wafted, that underneath the burning lion's breast beams in this hair, coming led with his might, thy mind be with thine eyes, and in them mirrored the shape which in this mirror shall be shown. Whoso can deem how fondly I had fed my sight upon her blissful countenance, may know when to new thoughts I change, what joy to do the bidding of my heavenly guide, in equal balance poising either weight. So here we had focused on two important points that we already discussed regarding that, in which again mine eyes were fixed on Beatrice. So here again is stressed, or again is personified. So this means that the narrator or the speaker of this poem, he looked on Beatrice, and with mine eyes, my soul that in her looks found all contentment, yet no smile she wore. So when the narrator looked this Beatrice, Beatrice said that not to look on me, in which yet no smile she wore. So this means that if she smiles, Dante would turn to ashes because they have climbed so high that they have reached the point where Dante's mortal senses cannot bear the brilliance of God's reflected love. So this is the first point that we have to keep in mind. Secondly, we have the announcement in which into the seventh splendor are we wafted, that underneath the burning lion's breast beams in this hour, coming light with his might, thy mind be with thine eyes, and in them mirrored the shape which in this mirror shall be shown. So here we have to focus on regarding their announcement in which they have reached the seventh heaven. And also, Beatrice tells him to look where he would usually look, and he will see the reflected image of what comes next. Dante looks at Beatrice's eyes, there he sees the landscape of the Saturn reflected. So this is the second point that you have to keep in mind. Then the third one is that, may know what to new thoughts I change, what joy to do the bidding of my heavenly guide in equal balance, poising either weight within the crystal which records the name of that loved monarch in whose happy reign no ill had power to harm, I so reared up. So here we have to focus on regarding the golden ladder, the image of this golden ladder. And rising from it is a magnificent golden ladder, extending so high that Dante cannot see its top. Climbing down the steps of the ladder are thousands upon thousands of souls. Then Dante compares their movement, gathering together and flitting about once they reach the surface of Saturn to the movement of the flock of jackdaws. So here we have to focus on two important points. The first one is regarding the golden ladder and also regarding the souls. So in color like to sun illuminate gold, a ladder which my ken pursued in vain, so loftily was the summit, down whose steps I saw the splendors in such multitude, descending every light in heaven, me thought. So here the descending every light in heaven means every soul in the heaven. Me thought was shed thence, as the rooks at dawn of day, bestirring them to dry their feathers chill, some speed their way afield and homeward some, returning cross their flight, while some abide and wheel around their airy lodge, so seem that glitterance after on alternate wing, as upon certain stair it came and clash its shining, and one lingering near us waxed so bright that in my thought I said, that love which this betokens me admits no doubt, unwillingly from question I refrain. So here Dante meets a soul from this ladder. Then Dante turns his attention to the nearest soul and thinks that he is so bright. So here the light means the bright of the soul, and he must be eager to speak, but he must await permission from the Beatrice before speaking to the soul. And at this unspoken thought, Beatrice promptly gives the signal and Dante's words are unleashed. So here we had focused on the two important questions from the Dante to this soul. Unwillingly from question I refrain, to her by whom my silence and my speech are ordered, looking for a sign whence she, who in the sight of him that seeth all. So wherefore I was silent, prompted me to indulge the fervent wish, and I began, I am not worthy of my own desert, that thou shouldest answer me, but for her sake, who hath vouchsafed my asking, spirit blessed, that in thy joy art shrouded, say the cause which bring thee so near, and wherefore say, doth the sweet symphony of paradise keep silence here, pervading with such sounds of rapt devotion every lower sphere? Mortal art thou in hearing as in sight, was the reply, and what forbade the smile of Beatrice interrupts our song. Only to yield these gladness of my voice and of the light that vest me, I thus far descend these hallowed steps, not that more love invites me, for lo, there aloft as much or more of love is witnessed in these flames, but such my lot by charity assigned, that makes us ready servants, as though seized to execute the counsel of the highest. So basically here Dante asks two important questions to soul. So the first question was that why he stepped up so close, and the second one was that why there is an unnatural silence in this sphere. So here the soul answers to the second question first, in which if we sing, it would burst your eardrums. In other words, Dante's moral hearings could not handle the glory of song at this level of heaven. So this was the answer to the second question. Then in response to the first question, the answer was that he descended the golden ladder with the purpose of meeting Dante. So this is the fourth point that we have to keep in mind, in which regarding the two questions by Dante to the soul and also the two answers by the soul to these questions. So that's regarding the fourth point that we have to keep in mind. Then to execute the counsel of the highest, that in this court said I, O sacred lamp, love no compulsion needs, but follows free the eternal providence I will discern. This harder find to deem why of thy peers, though only to this office were foredoomed, I had not entered, when like rapid mill upon its sender willed the light, and then the love that did inhabit there replied, splendor eternal, piercing through these folds, its virtue to my vision nicks, and thus supported, lifts me so above myself that on the sovereign essence which it wells from, I have the power to gaze, and hence the joy. So here we had to focus on regarding the fifth point. So here Dante says that I understand that you have aligned your will with God's, but I still don't understand why you in particular were predestined to meet me. Before he can even say the last words, the spirit begins spinning as fast it can go. Then predictably his spinning only makes the soul grow brighter, and he replies, my sight is good, which is why God blesses me with so much grace. But stop asking why, Dante. Then nobody can know the mind of God. So this is very important regarding this poem, in which I have the power to gaze, splendor eternal, piercing through these folds, its virtue to my vision needs, and thus supporter lifts me so above myself. സോ എന്തുകൊണ്ടാണ് ഇവിടെ ഈ ഒരു സോള്, പ്രത്യേകിച്ച് ഈ ഒരു സോള് ഇവിടെ ഡാൻഡേ കാണാൻ വന്നത് എന്നായിരുന്നു ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ. സോ ബേസിക്കലി ദി ആൻസർ ഫോർ ദാറ്റ് ക്വസ്റ്റ്യൻ വാസ് ദാറ്റ് ഗോഡ് പർട്ടിക്കുലർലി ഫേവേഴ്സ് ദിസ് സോൾ മോർ ദാൻ ദി അതേഴ്സ് ഓൺലി ദാറ്റ് ദിസ് സോൾ ഇസ് ഗവേൺഡ് ബൈ ഗോഡ്സ് വിൽസ് ആൻഡ് ദസ് ഒബേയ്സ് വെൻ ടോൾഡ് ടു മൂവ് ഡൗൺ ദി ലാഡർ. ദെൻ ആഫ്റ്റർ ദാറ്റ് ദ സോൾ സേസ് ദാറ്റ് നോബഡി ക്യാൻ നോ ദി മൈൻഡ് ഓഫ് ഗോഡ്, and you would do well to remind your fellow men of that when you return below. His haughty words makes Dante take a step back. So this is regarding the fifth point that we had to keep in mind, and after that he questions regarding the identity of the soul. Now we had to focus on the second part of this poem, in which wherewith I sparkle, equaling with my blaze the keenness of my sight, but not the soul that is in heaven most lustrous, nor the seraph that hath his eyes most fixed on God, shall solve what thou hast asked, for in the abyss it lies. For the everlasting statue sung so low that no created can may fathom it, and to the mortal world when thou returnest, be this reported, that none henceforth dare direct his footstep to so dread a bourne. The mind that there is radiant on the earth is wrapped in mist. Look then if she may do below what pass her ability. When she is taken to heaven by words like this, admonish, I the question argued no more, and of the spirit humbly sued alone to instruct me of its state, twist either shore of Italy nor distant from thy land a stony ridge arise in such short. The thunder doth not lift his voice so high. They call it Catria, at whose foot a cell is sacred to the lonely hermit, for worship set apart and holy rites. So here Dante asks a question to the soul again, in which it is the identity of the soul. So basically Dante meekly asks the soul his identity. The blazing soul responds that he once worshipped God in a palace called the Cantria, specifically in the monastery of Santa Croce di Forte Avellana, and in his meditation there, he was happy to live on a diet of veggies cooked only in olive juice. Then according to the soul, nobody can know the mind of God, and you will do well to remind your fellow men of that when you return below. His haughty words make Dante take a step back. Then he asks this question regarding the identity. Then the blazing soul responds that he once worshipped God in a palace called Catria. So the fifth point is regarding the identity of the soul. So they call it Catria, at whose foot a cell is sacred to the lonely hermit for worship set apart and holy rites. A third time thus it spake, then added, there so firmly to God's service I adhered, that with no costlier viands than the juice of olives, easily I passed the heats of summer and the winter frost the content. In heavenward musings, rich were the returns, and fertile, which that cloister once was used to render to these heavens, now this fallen to a waste so empty that their long detection must lay bare its vanity. So here the soul reveals its identity. Then the blazing soul responds that he was once worshipped God in a place called Catria, specifically in the monastery of Santa Croce di Forte Avellina. So basically it is a monastery, and he was from the place which is Catria. Also in his meditation there, he was happy to live on a diet of veggies cooked only in olive juice. And also that monastery used to turn out virtuous souls like clockwork, but it's now barren. So this means the fall of that monastery. So now we had to focus on the final part of this poem, in which the sixth point. So here the soul reveals its name. Petero Damanio, there was I kept, in which Peter the sinner when before I dwelt, beside the Adriatic in the house of our blessed lady, near upon my close of mortal life, through much importuning, I was constrained to wear the hat that still from bad to worse is shifted. Cephas came. So here Cephas came means the Saint Peter. And he came, who was the Holy Spirit's vessel, barefoot and lean, eating their bread as chance. At the first table, modern shepherds need those who on either hand may prop and lead them. So barely are they grown, and from behind others to host them. Down the palfrey's sides, spread their broad mantles, so as both the beasts are covered with one skin. O patience, though that looks on this, and those endure so long. I at those essence saw the splendorous down, from step to step allied, and wheel and vats, each circuiting more beautiful. Round this they came, and stayed them, uttered then a shout, so loud, it has no likeness here, nor I wished what it spake, so deafening was the thunder. So this is the final part of this poem, in which here we had focused on regarding the identity of the soul, in which he was the Peter Damian, and also he was called as the Peter the sinner when he first came to the monastery. From this place he was reluctantly dragged out and eventually became a cardinal. Then in the final part, the seventh point is regarding the final part of this poem, in which this gives Peter an opportunity to blast the papal seat. So here the papal seat means the seat of Pope. Then he recounts how popes were once good, as when Saint Paul wore the hat, he walked barefoot and was lean. But now, Peter shakes his head, the popes are so plump that they have need of one to prop them up. On this side, one of that, and one in front, and one to host them saddle-marked. So this is the current situation of the Pope according to the soul, the Peter Damian. And also, Peter's words have attracted the souls who are now gathered round in a spectacle of light. So it is very important regarding the spectacle of light. So it signifies the group of souls. So Peter's words have attracted the souls who are now gathered round in a spectacle of light. When Peter stops speaking, they cry out an agreement. Then and Dante drops like an anchor. Their combined voices have overwhelmed his senses as Saint Peter warned before. So this signifies the sound of the thunder in such a way that nor did I understand its words, its thunder overcame me so. So this signifies that Dante's mortal hearing could not handle the glory of song at this level of heaven. So here the sound of the thunder, it signifies the sound that overcame to Dante. So that's regarding the final part of this poem. So today we discuss regarding the Paradiso 21, the chapter 21, and also especially the seventh heaven, Saturn, that we had focused on. So basically this is the happiness of the contemplation, then the golden ladder, predestination, and also regarding Saint Peter domain. So these are the points that you have to keep in mind. So this is the seventh heaven, then it is the Saturn, then the happiness of contemplation, then the golden ladder, then predestination and Saint Peter domain. Along with that, we have seven important points that we have to keep in mind. So these are the topics that you have to keep in mind regarding this poem, and also we have some important topics regarding this poem, which includes the themes, the major characters, and also some important points regarding this poem. So we'll be discussing this topic in the next class. So today we discuss regarding the chapter, which is the Paradiso 21 in the Divine Comedy, which is the seventh heaven, Saturn. So that's for today. Thank you. Happy learning.